Hello, today lesson on AC power analysis is about apparent and complex power, and also at the end we will talk about the power factor. Last time we study about the average power, and for the AC signal, Vt equal to Vm cosine omega 3 plus theta V, and IT equal to Im cosine omega t plus theta I, and we said that the average power of the absorbed by the load is equal to P is equal to 1 over 2 Vm Im cosine theta V minus theta I, and the Vm Im is a V magnitude V max, which is a V peak or V maximum of the your signal, and so last time we also said that in term of VMS and IMS, average power is equal to VRMS IRMS cosine theta V minus theta I, and now you can see that we have two term mainly. And so we call another term which called S. S is equal to VRMS IRMS. And so P can be rewritten as S multiplied by cosine theta V minus theta I. And so we call this is as a apparent power, which is equal to VRMS multiplied by IRMS, and also and the other term, the second term, the cosine of the phase difference between voltage and current, we call it power factor, PF. So we can say that P equal to S multiplied by power factor, and also power factor is equal to P divided by apparent power. So you can see that the cosine, the phase difference between voltage and current, have some effect on the power factor. If this term is has an effect on average power, if this cosine theta V minus theta I higher, then the average power is higher too. And you can see that since power factor is equal to P divided by apparent power, or I forget to mention that for the average power, the unit is watt. And for the apparent power, the unit is VA. So actually, this one is a power unit. So since it's a ratio of average power to the apparent power, so power factor is dimensionless. There is no dimension. And since it's a cosine of theta V minus theta I, so this one will lead us into that power factor will have a range between 0 to 1. And for pure resistor, theta V and theta I equal. So cosine 0 is equal to 1. So for the power factor is equal to 1. And so we know that theta V and theta I for inductor and capacitor is 90 degree. So cosine 90 degree is equal to 0. So power factor of C and L is equal to 0. And so for and sometime you can see power factor in percentage. So it will range from 0 to 100%. If the power factor is equal to 0.8, then we can say that this one is a 80% power factor. And since C and L have a lead and lag, and when we would like to indicate lead or lag, we looking at the current. We know that for the current, the current passing R will have a 0 degree, right? And current of C will be up there, and IL will be in this. So for C, and also as I told you before, for when we would like to see the lead or lag power factor, we will look at the C lead, I lead V, or V lead, or I lag V. So for capacitor, current is a leading voltage. So this we also have a leading power factor. So when you find the it is a leading power factor, it implies that you will have a capacitive load. And oppositely, when you have a inductive load, this power factor become lagging power factor, since the current of the passing through L lag voltage. So again, the power factor is dimensionless. And when we look at, when we inspect with the load, we know that C is equal to V over I, and the phasor V is Vm theta V. Im is I, phasor I is Im theta I. So this turn out to be Vm over I, and the phase angle become theta V minus theta I. So you can see that and then we change this V max into VRMS. So since the VRMS is equal to V divided by square root 2, I is also divided by square root 2. So both square root 2 will deduct out. So the impedance, phasor impedance equal to, also equal to phasor VRMS divided by phasor IRMS, which is equal to its magnitude VRMS over IRMS, and then the phase is theta V minus theta I. So you can see that for power factor, this one is a cosine of theta V minus theta I. So we have the same term. So the power factor angle is equal to the angle of the load impedance. And we know that Z is equal to R plus J X, right? So we have R here, and then we have X, and then this one is theta, which is a power factor is also equal to cosine this theta too. So let's take a look at example 8. A series connected load draws a current and voltage as given below. I is equal to 4 cosine 100 pi t plus 10 degrees. So this one is equal to 4 10, and V is equal to 180 minus 20 degree in phasor form. Find the apparent power. This one is S, and the power factor PF of the load. Determine the element values form the series connected load. Okay, so we know that it is series connected. So let's start with the finding apparent power. S is equal to V RMS multiplied by I RMS. Since this one is Vm theta V, right? And this one is Im theta I. So VRMS is equal to Vm divided by square root 2. So it divided by 4 divided by square root 2 multiplied by V is 120 and multiply by current 4 divided by square root 2 which is equal to 240 and the unit is volt VA. And next we find the power factor. So we know that power factor is a cosine of theta V minus theta I. It's a cosine of phase difference between voltage and current, so it will be minus 20 minus 10. So you have a cosine 30 minus 30 degree, which is equal to 0.886 or 88.6% power factor. And since this one, the current lead voltage, so this one is a leading power factor. And next we have to find the element that form the series connected load. So we have to find C, right? Both C, phasor C. So C is equal to phasor I divided by C is equal to phasor V divided by phasor I. So phasor V is equal to magnitude and its phase divided by current 4 and 10 degree. So this one is 30 and then minus 30 degree, which is equal to 25.95 minus J15. So it means that C both C is equal to R plus JX, right? So R is equal to 25.55 ohm and minus J15 equal to minus J omega C, and omega is equal to 100. So this one is equal to so you have 15 equal to 1 over 100 and C. So C is equal to 1 over 15,000, right? So which is equal to 212.2 microfarad. So now we know the value that form the series connected load, and we get a correct answer, right? Because it go together, leading power factor. And let's move to one more example. Determine the power factor as seen by the source. Calculate the average power delivered to the by the source. So we have to search for power factor, and then we have to find the P, average power. So let's start with power factor. For power factor, we know that we have to know theta V minus theta I, right? Since power factor is equal to cosine theta V minus theta I. And we also know that theta V minus theta I, we can search, we can the angle of the phasor impedance is also theta V minus theta I. So we find C, and C is equal to sig in series with minus J2 in parallel with 4 ohm. So we will have sig plus J2 multiplied by 4 divided by 4 minus J2, which is equal to sig plus 0.8 minus 1.6 J. So we have 6.8 minus 1.6 J, which is equal to 7 minus 13.24 degree. So the power factor is equal to cosine minus 13.24 degree, which is equal to 0.9734. So we finish with the first question. Next, we need to find the apparent power. We already know that P is equal to VIMS I RMS cosine theta V minus theta I, which is the same as a power factor. So we know the VIMS 30. Next, we have to find the IMS. We know that phasor IMS is equal to phasor VIMS divided by C, phasor C. So this one is equal to 30.0 degree divided by 7 minus 13.24 degree, and we come up with 4.286 13.24 degree, and we find the P. P is equal to its magnitude 30 multiplied by 4.286 multiplied by 0.9734. So we will come up with 125 watt. And you can find it from P equal to IRMS square two. So this will be 4.286 multiplied by 2 multiplied by R is equal to 6.8. You also obtain 125 watt, and P is also equal to V square RMS over R2. You may obtain slightly different one than 125, but very close to due to the round up error. And next, we will study about the complex power. Both is complex power is equal to 1 over 2 phasor V multiply by phasor I conjugate. And since we know that phasor V is divided by square root 2 is equal to phasor VIMS, and also I phasor I divided by square root 2 equal to IRMS, so 1 over 2 both v both I conjugate can be rewritten as both v square root 2 multiplied by I conjugate square root 2 and so the complex power is equal to phasor VMS multiplied by phasor IMS conjugate and this the unit of volt is volt and the unit of m is m so the unit of the complex power is volt m volt ampere VA and since we know that phasor VMS is equal to its magnitude and its phase VMS and phase theta V phasor IMS is equal to its magnitude IMS and phasor I so complex power both S can be rewritten to can be rewritten as VMS IMS and phasor theta V minus theta I you can see that this one is a magnitude right and this one is phase so we can transform the polar form into the complex number VMS IMS and then cosine theta V minus theta I plus J sine theta V minus theta I so it you can see that it has two term real part VMS now let me change it to VRMS IIMS cosine delta theta theta V minus theta I and we call this term is P is a apparent power average power or real power and it says the real part of the complex power and the second term Q reactive power is equal to VMS IMS psi theta V minus theta I so when so we can form the triangular power triangle we will have active power P on the x axis so this one is P and we have reactive power Q on the imaginary axis which it can be both of minus so we can have plus Q and then minus Q since it is a phasor form so when we compute it P plus J Q the both S then its absolute value will be equal to square root P square plus Q square and so this one is magnitude right and the phase this one is theta V minus theta I and so since this one is only the magnitude so this is also equal to apparent power is equal to the magnitude of the complex power when we look at P and Q and complex S when we look at the power triangle you can see that when we have a source and then we have some kind of load R plus JX right so this one create P plus JQ and so it means that your source have to supply the power which is if you consider the magnitude then it's a magnitude of your complex power which is the apparent power and one will contribute to P and the other one will contribute to Q and for the P the average power or active power or real power this one is one that will dissipate to your load directly and it's an actual work of creating for example heat
light motion or all kind of works, whereas the reactive power, the Q, is kind of take away the power from your source. So this Q kind of something that kind of no use in term of generate the work. So on your right hand side, you will see the reactive power analogy with a glass of beer. Like for the person who drink beer, you would like to drink it liquid directly. So this one is kind of liquid part compared to the real power P, and the unit is what, right? And whereas the bubble over top of your gas, your glass is a reactive power, one amp reactive wall. So when you buy a glass of beer, you would like to have a lot of liquid part, P part. And from the power triangle, you can see that the Q can be both of plus Q and minus Q, where minus Q is a leading power factor and plus Q is a lagging power factor. And also you can have Q equal to zero. When Q equal to zero, it means that you have a resistive load and the power factor become equal to one. And so this one, if zeta is equal to zeta V minus zeta I, so your power factor is equal to cosine zeta. And since we know that P is equal to apparent power multiplied by power factor, P is equal to VMS IMS, right, cosine zeta. So it equal to apparent power. So we can find power factor if we know P and if we know apparent power. And we can also, if we know Q and if we know apparent power, then we can find zeta. So such that zeta is equal to Q divided by apparent power. And also tan zeta is equal to Q divided by P. And since the one that work contribute to our work is P, so we would like to make Q really really small, and we would like to make the power factor become one. So the best power factor, the most effective, occur when power factor is equal to 1.
Let's inspect our complex power related to load C. We know that for phasor C, phasor impedance is equal to phasor voltage divided by phasor current, and is equal to phasor VMS divided by IMS. And so when we written in term of polar form, it's equal to VMS divided by IMS magnitude and the phase difference between cosine zeta V minus zeta I. So since we know that S complex power is equal to phasor VMS multiplied by IMS, phasor IMS conjugate. So we know that VIMS is equal to IIMS multiplied by phasor C. So we replace this with this one. It turned out that we will have complex power equal to IMS square multiplied by phasor C. And it's also similarly, you will come up with the complex power is also equal to VMS square divided by phasor C conjugate. And since C is equal to R plus JX, this one is R, right? This one is X. And so we have that. And so when we put this into this one, we come up S is equal to IMS square multiplied by R plus JX, which is equal to P plus JQ. So the real part is also equal to IMS square multiplied by R. And the imaginary part Q is equal to IMS square multiplied by X. So P is the real part of the compact power, and Q is the imaginary part of the complex power. Next two slide, our last two slides summarize what we have studied so far. So it will include all the power definition and its relevant mathematic equation. So you have, after finish this script, you should be able to compute the complex power and then the average power, real power, and reactive power. And so you have to be able to compute all power factor and the impedance C and power factor from the load impedance. And also you have to be able to relate between the complex power with the apparent power and the real power and reactive power. So we will finish our class with this slide. Thanks.